So what we're going to do is we're going to transition right now, and I would like to call up Gary Farrell, the President and CEO of Ag Enterprise Supply. And our session now is going to be the importance of local agricultural retailers on improving micro and macro nutrient management and efficiency. So while we segue here, Gary, welcome. Gary Farrell grew up on a dairy farm in Northwest Idaho. He has spent the last 42 years in the retail fertilizer ag chemical industry, and for the last 31 years, Gary has owned and operated his own independent crop production supply company. He serves his customers in Eastern Washington, dryland farming area, and he's the past, got a nice resume here, he is the past chairman of the Ag Retailers Association, a member of the National Cover Crop Committee, a member of the Soil Health Institute Policy Committee, and co-chair of the Washington State Soil Health Committee. So again, welcome and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much. It's an honor and pleasure. You'd think after all those years, I'd probably know what I was talking about, but every day when I get up, I find that there's always something new to be learned in this journey. We started out in this process several years ago, and we've been doing nutrient management processing for, I guess, ever since I've been in the industry. On my own, of course, doing it the old way was considerably different, so I'm going to try and give you a general overview today of how we've changed and adapted to the new and more modern way of doing things in terms of the nutrients and the macro-micro world and its efficiencies and how we go about doing things. Oops. So our goal as a local ag retailer is to improve the micro-macro nutrient management and efficiency process. We choose to use technology and experience of our CCA agronomists to make the best agronomic use of the nutrient investment for our customers and the environment. By using the 4 R's and precision ag technology, we have found ways to reduce nutrient usage and maximize the return on investment with increased yields, which is the obvious overall goal of our customers. We've reduced the nitrogen application so that the money saved can be used to purchase the needed micronutrients that we hadn't been able to use previously. And they've been overlooked in the past due to the not having money in the budget. So part of our project initiative partners that we really worked hard to try and develop a better relationship with, we worked with the conservation districts in Okanagan, Spokane, Blues Rock Lake, Lincoln County conservation districts. We worked hard with those folks. We are blessed to have innovative growers spread throughout the different rainfall areas within Eastern Washington and the dryland farming area. We're a real strong supporter and proponent of the Pacific Northwest Direct Seed Association, and we've also worked hard to establish a relationship with our Washington State Natural Resource Conservation Service. So our project goals and objectives: work with growers who have adopted yield monitor technology to determine realistic yield goals within field zones, determine the proper fertilizer rates based on those goals, taking into account the varying efficiencies due to the organic matter, cation exchange capacity, and pH, to determine whether the cover crops and alternative crops, which we consider to be flax, sunflowers, and canola, affect soil health and fertility requirements, determine whether the addition of certain nutrients will be beneficial in maximizing cover crop, cash crop efficiencies, and better connect agricultural retailers and NRCS personnel and service with joint customers based on the shared goal of improving soil health. Some of these get a little bit busy, and I'll apologize in advance. Some of them are a little difficult to read, and I'll try and get through them as best. So some of our histories over the last 3 years are attempting to fine-tune the fertility recommendations for alternative crops, as there are no guidelines that exist in our area, particularly the low rainfall area of Eastern Washington, for flax, sunflower, buckwheat, etc. Soil testing pre-plant, post-plant harvest, or post-harvest, to try to determine the removal and nutrient deficiencies. developing cover crops in an 8 to 10 inch rainfall area, and in some zones we're up to 18 to 22 inches. Direct seeding of cover crops rather than conventional methods of seeding, using soil moisture probes to prove current chem fallow is losing moisture without cover crops, changing the rotations and incorporating cover crops for grazing, and moisture improved down to 3 feet in a grazing cover crop with no summer hands. Cover crops in our area are finally starting to take hold or get some interest generated. It's always the first word out of every customer's mouth is we don't have moisture to support it. We've got 3 years data as of this year that proved them wrong in that regard. We've actually increased soil moisture in our cover crop acres, which is significant in terms of their rotations. We implemented precision applied variable rates of nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur, as well as banded micronutrients, sourced and provided cover crop seed to the grower. I believe they're seeing improved crop health in all zones, but particularly in the low production zones as a result of not over-fertilizing, and this should help mediate pH over time, if not seeding fertility holding capacity based on CDC. Using grid soil test maps, variable rate fertilizer application maps, yield maps, chemical application maps, and other data sets to figure out productivity zones, determine if the macronutrient for sulfur and zinc are really successful for high quality productivity. Reduce the amount of pre-plant nitrogen fertilizer for winter wheat, introduce split timing stream jet applications to the top of the soil, and with herbicide applications if needed. All nitrogen used to be applied at the beginning of crop season. Some of the barriers that we've encountered along the way is the perception there's not enough moisture to support cover crops. Absentee landlords, such as land management companies and or banking institutions, are economically driven and don't understand soil health as a long-term investment, which we've come to find in certain situations is a real barrier that we're going to have to figure out a way to get through. Adopting new methods, having to figure out which cover crops will grow in our area, presents another challenge. Accessibility of information. Once again, there's a ton of it out there, but trying to get it situated so it can be localized is another one of our needs. The economics of cover crop is a hard sell, even with the grower community. Lenders want to see a return on investment when you show cost per acres, and intrinsic values of the cover crops don't show up on the balance sheet, unfortunately. Some of the recommendations for best practices. We use technology to become efficient and cost-effective. By saving money on nitrogen fertilizer, they are able to invest in micronutrients they hadn't previously been able to afford. This will increase productivity and crop quality. The results will lead to increased environmental benefits and financial gain for the farmers. Farmers need to look at how they can adapt soil health practices in their current management systems. For example, in the dry areas, we've found that canola is as good as a cover crop as a cash crop as well, improving soil health and farmers' economic bottom line. The NRC and ag retailers watch their little path to put the customer in the middle. To better serve our joint customers, we need to get more involved with each other and get better at utilizing each other's resources. Find ways to open lines of communication so both parties can be aware of what the other is doing. One suggestion is to do this would be to find a way to get both parties interacting with each other such that each is more aware of what they are doing. Another issue that needs to be resolved as we look forward is to streamline a way for our CCA certified agronomists to become certified as TSPs. We've been doing the work as TSPs for years, and we provided that information to the grower to have their contracts accepted. We do the work, and we haven't been able to be financially compensated for the work we do. We're trying to become a certified TSP. Entered into that challenge several years ago, and me being retail and independent, trying to get through the bureaucratic process was a bit more than I was able to chew. So hopefully we'll be able to find a way to resolve that as we get down the road. Now I'm going to get into the data portion, and I don't really want to overwhelm you with a lot of stuff that's on here, so I'm just going to kind of highlight some of it. I apologize for the color shows up right there, and it does actually here. But so anyway, when we go into our nutrient management cycle, we start with the previous year's harvest yield map. Now, this map that you see here is what we've used to base everything on for the 2017 growing season. It went on record, this growing season went on record as one of the hottest seasons without rainfall in our area for this year. Nutrient management system still provided us with an increase in yield, yet the overall average yield was reduced due to the extreme heat. We have used this mapping system since 2008 with great results and practice what we preach for ours. So this is the map that was used from the previous harvest. It's a five zone yield map. Grower started with five zone, and this particular grower started with a five zone in their CS contract. At the time, they seemed to think that was the way to go, which we found out later wasn't necessarily correct. But anyway, we've edited the raw harvest yield data into a five zone map, and we'll reference this map throughout the growing season moving forward. So that previous map that we had taken from the harvest data was then established zones to establish GPS coordinates that will be used for soil and tissue testing in the five yield zones. This is part of our results that we got from our soil testing, and there's a lot of information, and I'm just trying to give a 10,000 foot overview and not get into a lot of detail. So basically, we broke it into the green zone, and at the end, there wasn't enough differentiation between the five zones and what the potentials were and what the results were, so we were able to get them reduced into a three zone map for this particular season. So this shows the green zone, and it had 40 pounds of VAN in the soil and an estimated 3-4 pounds of organic matter release for a total of 80 pounds available. The green and the light green zones were combined in one zone to make this into a three zone system. As you can see, the light green zone, which if we had gone with the five zones, has relatively similar nutrients in that area, so as an average. Third yellow zone, ended up with 41 pounds of soil in, 27 organic matter in, for a total of 76 pounds of VAN available for that growing season. The orange zone, which would have been the fourth zone, was very similar in requirements to the fifth zone, so we once again combined the orange and red zones into one red. So at that point, the red zone first showed it had a lot more nitrogen, 83 pounds, 22 from organic matter, for a total of 108 pounds, which was quite high in such poor soil. We do have some issues with the caliche layers in our soils out there. Sometimes that can impact that in these lower producing regions. So this particular spreadsheet was put together by one of my agronomists. The spreadsheet shows the planting involved with each zone. We use soil test results from each zone to help calculate the nitrogen input rates by projected yield in each zone. Soil credit of nitrogen in each zone is also included. At this point of a discussion with the local NRCS office, the five original zones were reduced to three more manageable zones at this stage. So we combined green and light green, we had yellow, combined orange and red. So now we sit down with our producers and go over the plan and make the final decision to program the variable rate application software. We determined that the average yield goal of this was 65 bushels for this year. This map is one that shows the fertilizer rates that were applied during the direct seeding operation, precision zone. Precision ag variable rate mapping was used. So in the green zones, we figured we were needing another 36 pounds of nitrogen. Yellow zone received 21 pounds, red orange zone received nothing. We're using lower rates of N that are placed with our seed. We split apply N, we get our better emergency and more plant vigor after emergence, increasing the overall yield potential. This is a map showing the split applications. After we had planted, we came back late fall and we reapplied. This is the map that shows the split application. Shows the rates were applied in zones. Zones were controlled by GPS software along with section control. This gives us an accurate variable rate application. So basically this is a string jet application. And it was applied with a nitrogen stabilizing unit, a compound also to help stabilize movement. Spring of the crop year, we used the soil test map that had been generated previous to show us where to take our tissue tests. The tests are taken in the same spots where the soil tests were taken, so we can continue the correlation between the two. GPS points are shown where the samples were taken from each zone. We can then determine what, if any, nutrients will be top drift supplied in spring for wheat. These are the results of those tissue tests. And once again, we combine the light green and green zones. So the nitrogen range, according to the recommendations, was 2 to 2.5 parts. Our results were 3.2, so we determined we didn't need any more nitrogen. Yellow zone was similar. 2 to 3.5, results were 3.4. And more N was required. Red zone, same. So no more nitrogen was applied at this particular point, which in the past, in the days of conventional use, we probably would have applied some. Current crop year 5-zone yield map. So this was the map that was generated from this last fall's harvest. And we're seeing excellent agronomic results as a result of using the forage nutrient management system. We've experienced better nutrient management, soil health, and profits for our customers. The yield map showed a 46.67 yield, bushel yield per acre. And not, but the, come to find after the fact that the monitor had not been elevated before harvest, unfortunately. So the actual weight, the actual yield established from weight tickets was 57 bushels per acre, which was still close. But the average tea yield for this field was 41 bushels. So the high heat and no moisture are a potential of 65, but we still felt quite fortunate to hit the 57 at this point. So at the end of the year, after harvest, of course we go out and we soil test once again. We utilize a program that Washington State University has available to us for dryland weak nitrogen needs. And it's so busy and it's hard to read and it's unfortunate, but so I highlighted some of the things that were worthy on the side there. The green, this is a green zone once again. Now this worksheet is used to show the nitrogen efficiency start to finish. So in the notes at the bottom, it says the N balance exceeds 50%. The N pounds per bushel produced is better than average. The crop usage, the nitrogen uptake efficiency was 147%. Pounds of soil plus applied nitrogen per bushel produced was 1.0 pounds of N per bushel. Potential result residual nitrogen left after harvest was a minus 46 pounds. When we go into our yellow zone, once again the N balance exceeds 50%, and pounds of N per bushel produced is better than average. Crop usage, the N uptake efficiency was 96%. So pounds of soil plus applied nitrogen per bushel produced 1.6 pounds of N per bushel. Potential residual N left after harvest was 3 pounds. Now we get to the rib, a little different story. A large amount of N may have been left in the field. Now it's relatively obvious. Pounds of N per bushel produced is worse Usage, the uptake efficiency was only 46%. Pounds of soil applied to N per bushel produced 3.3 pounds of N per bushel of clay. Potential results of N left in the field after harvest is 50 pounds, which we're going to have to start to find better ways of dealing in those lower potential zones. So as a summary of this particular crop year, of course we began the process of using the previous year's crop yield map to establish our zones. Yield map had 5 zones, which were converted into 3 manageable zones. Zone map was used to establish soil test points. Soil test results were analyzed for nutrient requirements. Nitrogen application rates were established for the zone. Zone maps were used to apply nitrogen for seeding. The balance of nitrogen requirement was variable rate zone applied late fall. First tissue tests were taken in the spring. Tissue test results were analyzed to determine no more nitrogen was needed. Current crop year yield map was produced at harvest. The yield monitor results were corrected based on actual weight of the harvested crop. Post-harvest soil tests were taken and sent to WSU. Use less nitrogen to grow this crop compared to conventional broadcast methods. To save money on nitrogen, we're using the balance on the micronutrients, which are basically zinc and boron for our area. The growth budget has the same amount per acre, but it's used more efficiently. Utilizing 4 hours of precision ag technology, we were able to utilize the nutrients more efficiently. End of the day, it's about economics, stewardship, and improved soil health. And I guess as I close, I will say, please embrace change in the name of soil health. With that, thank you.
Any questions for Gary? Gary, I have one. You know, there's that saying, we manage what we measure. And as you look at the nutrients and the measurements, do you see a lot of trends and data about actual soil loss itself, besides just the loss of the nutrients, but the soil loss movement within fields, or is there anything measured there?
I think there are correlations, definitely. We're utilizing the direct seed application now, no-till. What's called in it last week called direct seeding because no-till fly in our area. Most of our customers are direct seeding, which has improved significantly the conservation process of maintaining soil position and not overworking it. So I think there are correlations as we go forward that we'll be able to learn from that.
Okay, and you also mentioned about, you know, there wasn't a lot of data, I think, on some of those alternative crops or, you know, data, the fertility rates, I believe.
Right.
Who's responsible for that? I mean, who do you see having that data, that information?
Most of our data will come from our Land Grant University, Washington State University, and actually University of Iowa right next door. They're in the process of working on finding some different requirements as we search for finding different types of crops that we can integrate into our management systems.
So I would anticipate you could see some growth in that area, hopefully.
Absolutely. They're working very hard, and we certainly try to help out as best we can. We have a research farm kind of in between my 2 retail outlets, and we work with them as much as we can, too.
Okay.
You said that one of your statements in your slideshow was that there was improved water retention in those strips that you had the cover crops planted. Was that, and I only saw it quickly on the screen, was that versus chemical fallow?
Yes.
And if that was true, was that due to the mechanics of the root zone of those cover crops or the livestock grazing breaking up the top of the soil? What were the mechanics of that?
This was in a whole, I guess, different concept of what I was planning to talk about. I gave one a talk like this in Indianapolis here a few weeks ago on cover crops, but we have a situation in the western region of our area that's a 8 to 10 inch rainfall. So we plant a cover crop, It had corn and sorghum, sunflowers, turnips and radishes. And the intent was to grow that and graze it. And then we compared that next door to Kemp Fallow. And we have a soil probe that we're using, we're a distributor of it. It's a 4-foot probe and it measures soil temperature, root development every 4 inches, and it sends it out remotely every 15 minutes so we can monitor and watch all of the moisture levels here. So what we found at the end of this cycle, the grower on the cover crop grazed early, and then it started getting late and he got concerned about possible problems with the Sedangas. And of course we should have tested, you know, over there, but it just kind of gets busy and panics. And so they pulled the catalog in probably early September. And when we were out there in late October, we soil tested again and we looked at moisture, and there was actually about 1.6 inches more available moisture and 3 feet in the cover crop than there was in the conventional Kemp Fallow. So, you know, two things. Of course, the cover crop is certainly keeping the surface temperatures of the soil lower, which we can substantiate with our probes, as opposed to Kemp Fallow. And I think we were all really surprised, inasmuch as we've not had any rain from planting in May until that time in October, how we ended up with that much more moisture. But obviously, it's maintaining, it's wicking, it's doing a lot of things that we're still having to watch. The one most interesting thing we found in several of the different segments of our cover crop experience, I'm kind of deviating now, but we found a significant increase in soil pH comparatively to the check of the Kemp Fallow. And in this one instance, now I don't know, it seems a little much, but it was almost 1.5 points difference in pH. In two other locations in higher rainfall, we had one other situation, we had 1 point differential higher in the cover crop area. Too. So, you know, is that an anomaly? Maybe. But it's something we're certainly going to watch, because if we can substantiate any type of a soil pH increase, that will make the sale and usage of cover crops much easier. That's a significant issue in our farming area.
Gary, if you were going to sit down with a new NRCS or Conservation District employee and give them some advice to them and their supervisor on what their training should be, are the things that you would suggest that get incorporated into their training, into their professional development, that maybe isn't happening right now?
Well, first thing I'd do, I would ask them to lace up their boots and come out and spend a couple of days with my field of grounds to get a feel for what it is that goes on out in the real world. You know, the divide has been such that this is what got me started way back when I was first started into this MOU process, was that we need to each know better. I had conversations with people that didn't really understand at all what it was we do for the farmers. You know, that we're the ones that actually do the nutrient management that they present in order to get their TSP or CSP process certified. Mm-hmm. We do that work for them. It's just a matter we need to communicate. We need to understand. My people need to understand what's being told to our customers from this side of fence, and their people need to understand what's being told by us on this side of fence. You know, we're in a precarious position because we have to throw in agronomics. On one side of the fence, agronomics really isn't taken totally into consideration. Now it's all, well, in the real world, it's this should work. Well, yes, it should. But on our side of the fence, then we have to take into account reality of what is the financial implications and ramifications of trying to do what it is we're trying to accomplish. So, yes, I think it's just both. I think my my CCA agronomists are learning to talk to our local NRCS people, but consistency is difficult because consistency of what is coming from national to state. Sometimes there's a lot of stuff lost in translation from state to region, it's lost from region to local. Even within the local office, we have two or three people within the NRCS office that have different interpretations of how they think it should be done. And it needs to be more consistent. I don't know, I think there's real opportunity. So we just need to go out. When I first took the opportunity to introduce myself to my state con, Roy Lee rides at the door, I went in and we had a wonderful 2.5 hour conversation. I learned a lot. She learned a lot. I invited her to our grower meeting to hear what we tell our growers. Once again, she learned a lot. My time spent in there ended up costing me being asked to be the co-chair of our Washington State Soil Health Committee. Which is fine.
Right.
That's a wonderful, it's a wonderful thing to be able to be a part of it. And hopefully, you know, as we move this and we process forward, we'll be able to find a way to bridge that divide.
Gary, I want to thank, because I think what you've just articulated is what's happening here today. We're trying to have that cross-pollination, for lack of a better buzzword, of just how things are done in the real life in scenario and how we can improve collectively together what we can do. And I think of one of my most successful districts back in Minnesota, they were constantly putting on, you know, working with our certified crop advisors, the land grant university, bringing in the landowners and constantly having a conversation about technology, information, and obviously then the conservation program. So again, balancing the public and private. So with that, I would like to say we have a half hour break.
It is
15 minutes. I'm sorry. I might have did head to the entry. So 15 minutes. We'll be back in 10:45. So thank you. Let's give Gary a round of applause.